Hey, folks. Andras Jones here.
And Brian Connolly.
And this is one of those intros you've grown to love and or skip over. What do we got to say to the folks about this upcoming episode?
Oh, so this is basically our Halloween episode. This is, you know, part of the scary month of October. Last week we started to lean into horror movies that aren't necessarily horror movies but are really scary with Bob Roberts, and this week we're doing The Rules of Attraction, which is a terrifying tale. Terrifying. To say the least.
Yes, very scary. My my girlfriend watched it and she was like, I could see being triggered by this. And I was like, you mean by the sexual assault? She's like, well, yeah. And she's like, you mean the cocaine and the heroin use? Yeah, well, that too. And the suicide? Well, yeah, that was very troubling. And how about the overdoses? Yeah, that. But it's James Vanderbeek's face was the thing. She really, really doesn't like James Vanderbeek's face. And I said, well, then did you like seeing him getting beaten up? She's like, no, I don't dislike the guy. I just wish I had known I was going to have to look at him so much. So... Trigger warnings abound, folks. Trigger warnings abound. It's a terrifying film. And I should know, because I'm easily terrified.
Because you, despite being, you know, famous for being in horror movies, you don't tend to really like to watch horror movies, which is interesting.
No, I don't like being scared. I'm scared. I woke up terrified this morning without seeing anything, just looking out my window.
Can you handle like amusement park rides? Can you handle that level?
No,
of scare?
I don't like. I hate amusement park. I like Ferris wheels and things like that. But the ones that fake you out, like they're gonna throw you off the edge and then turn really quick. I don't like that.
Can you handle driving a car?
Yeah, of course I can.
Okay, all right.
So I mean, the car so isn't, like... it's not designed, that's the thing. Scary things will happen in a car. I've been in a car and had scary things happen to me. But the car isn't designed to terrify me. That's the thing. I don't like being messed with. I don't like being, sometimes, I mean, I love movies. Movies mess with you all the time. I like it when movies manipulate me to make me cry or make me laugh, even to make me angry, but scared.
In your lifetime, what movie scared you the most that you couldn't even finish it or you just like were scarred by it?
Well, what's the movie based upon a video game series with Mila Jovovich in it?
Oh, Resident Evil?
Resident Evil. I remember that was the last time I actually went to a movie, a scary movie. And I was with a bunch of people. It's when I was living at Andy Dick's place. It was like a Andy Dick adventure. And there was this cute young woman who was sitting next to me. And I was grabbing her. I was like the cliche girl in a horror film. And she was like, I think she kind of had a crush on me. It kind of flipped the thing. She was like, oh, afterwards, she's like, you were holding my hand a lot. I was like, yeah, because I was terrified. I'm never going to put myself through that again. Never, never. She was like, oh, I thought you were, I thought you were like me. I was like, no, I was scared.
Have you been so scared at a movie that you fainted?
No. No, I've never. I leave. I don't faint. I leave. Doesn't that sound like that could be a Woody Allen line? I don't faint. I leave.
Well, you certainly were terrified. If for Rules of Attraction, you can tell when you listen to the episode that you were very scared by this one as well.
Yeah, I'm scared that someday I may write a book and then have a filmmaker come and completely change the intentions of it in the movie. That's a scary thought for all creative people.
All writers deal, even screenwriters deal with that fear.
Oh, yes.
Once it's in the hands of someone else, it gets taken away from you. Happy Halloween, everybody. We're excited that you're listening. If there's no crazy news on our end or anything, we just wanted to say hello and happy Halloween.
And
remember to vote. Remember to vote.
Yes, yes. You may not have heard of it, but there's an election coming up. And it's actually going on right now. So have you voted yet, Brian?
I'm going to do it tomorrow. I was waiting for some of the lines to die. Everyone in Texas went crazy with coming out to vote, which is great. So, like, the lines have been very long, so I've just been waiting for it to die down. So I think I feel confident that tomorrow won't take more than an hour.
You're doing in-person voting.
Yeah, they don't let you do mail-in here. You have to do it in person.
Well,
that's how it is.
I live in Washington, where you're not allowed to vote in person. You have to vote by mail.
That's funny. No, Texas is acting like everything's fine, so it's not. But we're pretending that it is.
Oh,
so,
and
I'm
going to
wear
a
mask. I'll vote.
And this has nothing to do with the scare, but I feel like I just had a friend who flew on an American Airlines flight, and they're not social distancing on American Airlines. So if you, this is a public service announcement for anyone who is braving the sometimes friendly skies. Make sure you find out what airplane or what airline you're flying on, and that they are continuing to do social distancing. As far as I understand, American Airlines and Southwest are not. Alaska and Delta are. I hope that the ones who are doing the money grab go out of business, and the ones who are protecting human lives are rewarded for it. So I think that's scarier than anything in. Isn't that terrifying? You'd show up for an air, and they wouldn't refund their ticket either. It's like, sorry.
Was this American Airlines?
Yeah, on American Airlines. Yeah.
Fuck American Airlines.
Well, on that happy message, let's check out Rules Don't Apply, shall we, Bryan?
Yeah. No Rules of Attraction. We did Rules Don't Apply already.
Oh, damn. I love Rules Don't Apply.
We just love rules. We're gonna watch Rules of the Game next time. We're just going to keep going.
Yeah, it's
going
to be the Law and Order show. Just all about the rules.
Wonderful. All right, well.
Hi, I'm Bryan.
And I'm AJ.
And we have a podcast called The Director's Wall.
Examining a filmmaker's career, film by film. First up was M. Night Shyamalan, then Francis Ford Coppola. Who's next? Is there anything to this whole auteur theory? Find out on
The Director's Wall.
Subscribe via Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, or your preferred listening platform.
I'm Larry Bishop, and you're listening to The World is Wrong podcast.
We're here to tell you how the world is wrong. The world is wrong about
the rules of attraction.
It's like I'm around a campfire.
Well, you are. You are around the World is Wrong podcast campfire. This is the extremely positive podcast where we celebrate and champion films that the world is wrong about. And we got one of those for you today on our very, very spooky Halloween episode of the World is Wrong podcast. What have you picked for us, Bryan Connolly?
I picked The Rules of Attraction, and you know what? There's no movie scarier than this, guaranteed.
It is frightening. It's really, yeah. Well, I can't, I've had such a powerful experience with this film since we decided to do it. So I'm really excited for this conversation. Bryan, why don't you tell us about this film?
It's a story that might bore you, but you don't have to listen because I always knew it was going to be like that. And it was, I think, in that last year, or actually weekend, really a Friday in December at Camden, and this was years ago when I was a different person and I was so drunk that I ended up losing my virginity. I lost it to some guy who I thought was a ceramics major, but was actually either an NYU film student who was just up to Camden for the end of the world, or a townie. I actually had my eye on someone else that night. Victor.
I'm telling you, with European girls, it's just a numbers game. If you stand in any major European city on any fucking corner, and you consecutively ask every girl that walks by if she'll fuck you, one out of 20 will say yes.
A junior, a drama major, just back from Europe. Hey, only a little gay with flecked blonde hair, a great body, and these amazing gray eyes.
Bam. 20th one, you're fucking right there. It's a confirmed statistic on that.
But Victor was fucking my roommate, Lara. She gave him mono before he dumped her. I'm told that later, after I left Camden, she got really drunk and went wandering through Wyndham House. And did the whole football team. She's now married to a senator and has four kids. How time distorts things.
So you know the movie I'm talking about, huh? She was wrongfully labeled a Tarantino film, even though he was just credited as an executive producer.
So this guy from NYU or whatever, who wasn't even a good Victor facsimile,
you know, I think for example,
and I were talking on this ratty old couch.
All right, well, let's talk about this movie. It came out in 2002, I believe. It's directed by Roger Avary, whom, if you know him at all, it's because he helped write Pulp Fiction. And it's based on a book by Bret Easton Ellis, who was famous for writing the books of Less Than Zero and American Psycho. And he, you know, he deals with difficult characters and difficult people. And man, is this movie just chock full of it. It's basic. It's like the Uber version of Bret Easton Ellis, I would say, because it's not just one bad person. It's all bad people. And so because it's Roger Avary, it has this Pulp Fiction-esque sort of quality of telling the stories out of order, coinciding, like the same, you know, it's like it's all over the place, you know, narratively. And basically, though, your main characters are, you have Sean Bateman, played by James Vanderbeek. And Sean Bateman, of course, is the brother of Patrick Bateman from American Psycho. You have the character of Lauren Hind, played by Shannyn Sossamon. I think that's how you say her name. And then you have the character of Paul Denton, played by Ian Somerhalder. And it's basically you're at this Ivy League sort of college, and you're following these three characters around, and it's introduced at the beginning at this party. I believe is this the end of the world party? I think that's what they called it. And you're following each one. Lauren, she is a virgin, I think is supposed to be. And it's her having just right off the bat, this movie starts with uncomfortable sexual violence with her. And just dealing with awful, you know, college dudes. And then you follow Paul, who is a gay man. And he's having his own problems. He gets, I wouldn't say hazed, but he gets, you know, pushed and shoved and picked on for being gay pretty right off the bat. And then you have Sean, who is a psychopath, a sociopath, and you don't quite know what he's up to. You know that he looks like he just got in a fight, and what the fuck is he going to be up to? And you're just following him through college, and because it's Bret Easton Ellis, there's lots of drug use, and there's lots of disturbing violence, and there's just bad behavior all around and horrible behavior all around. And a lot of people think this movie is fun, and a lot of people think the movie's not fun, but I think we're going to talk about it anyways. But like, that's sort of the plot. Like, there's not really a lot going. It's just like this. It's kind of like a year in the life of these college kids as they're dealing with the horrors of being in college.
So, well, I guess, how is the world wrong about this film? And also, how is this film a horror film for you?
Let's start with how the world is wrong. And I guess it answers the other question too. So like very few movies I feel have people as divided as this one. Like I can name a handful and they're all kind of similar in a way. It's a movie about terrible, terrible people doing terrible, terrible things. And a lot of people equate that with, well, that means it's a terrible movie. But my argument is, no, this is a great movie just about terrible, terrible people. Much like Wolf of Wall Street, another movie that had people very divided. Like, that's a movie about terrible, awful people, but what a great movie. Or like Nightcrawler would be another example, or Taxi Driver. I guess Scorsese likes making movies about terrible people. Goodfellas, they're murderers. You know, like, you can make a good movie about bad people. But so many people, like even the often quoted from me, Leonard Maltin, gave this movie a bomb. He's like, what a disgusting, despicable film. And it's like, well, is the film itself despicable, or is it about despicable things? And I guess that's also part of the argument or question is like, can a movie be about despicable people but not be a despicable movie? Some people say no. Some people say yes. And I think that's sort of why it's a horror film to me, in the same way that you could say Wolf of Wall Street's a horror film, or Last Week with Bob Roberts, is that it's about truly terrible people and not just monsters, not ghosts. Like, this is like reality in a deeply disturbing way. And I think even maybe more disturbing than a murderer. Like, I feel that this movie or this book is more upsetting than American Psycho. It's more upsetting than Patrick Bateman, you know, axe murdering people. Sean Bateman is like destroying more lives with just the way he treats them as people. And like, these are college kids. So these are people at the start of their adult life, and they're going to go on and be in charge of things and run things and have families and make children. And that's scary. That's more scary than, you know, Dracula popping out of a coffin.
Yeah. 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 It is a well said. Well said, Brian. So, do you want to know what I think about this film?
Well, tell me what you think about this movie. Sure.
I've thought everything about this movie. I love the movie. I have thought a lot of different things about the movie in preparation for this podcast. When I first saw it several years ago, I thought it was great. I thought it was funny. I thought it was dark. I thought it was incredibly well made. Cinematically, it just had me from the jump. Is like, I'm interested in being in this place. I felt sort of flattered by the film's brutality, and it's sort of the way it was letting the audience feel like, oh, we're better than, like, we get to judge these people. And then when you said you wanted to do it, I got really excited because I know it's a divisive film, and I understood my initial reaction to it was so positive. And then I went and tracked down the book on tape and listened to that. And that definitely changed my view of the film because of some of the changes that Roger Avary made. Now, I know you have some strong feelings about comparing film adaptations to the source material, which I think is something I want to get into, because I think I don't disagree with your opinion about that. And at the same time, I feel like especially because this was a very popular book by a very popular author, the changes that the director makes are at least interesting and worth talking about. They're choices. They seem like choices. And that's where my relationship to the film got more complex. But we're going to get into that. We'll get into that later. And I did want to talk about how I see it as a horror film. Very similar to what you're saying is that, you know, it portrays both. It's horrific to me, both on the level of what it says about speaking to my generation. In the book, it takes place in 1984 in a college, and I would have been I graduated from high school in 86. So it's around, I feel like it's like a lot of the musical references, a lot of the cultural references in the book, it's speaking to my generation and about my generation. And I definitely relate to a lot of the dynamics that are in it. And then it also says something horrific about Hollywood in 2002 when it was made. And that also gets into like the changes that were made from the book to the film that say something about that time in Hollywood, which is also pretty horrific and frightening. And I guess the part that's really horrific and I think makes it a great film and a great horror film is this way where when certain people see it, you feel entertained and included by it. And then afterwards, you have to reckon with, well, what is it about me that makes me gravitate to and feel comfortable in this terrible world? Am I one of these monsters? If I had the opportunity, would I be one of these monsters? And I think that's probably maybe the more complex and the more frightening way to look at it than just to say, as some people would, oh, this is terrible. I cancel. You know,
yeah.
like this, you know, it's certainly fair to not want to watch this film.
Definitely. And when I first saw it, I turned it off. Like, it's like that sexual
you
assault
had,
scene.
You
in the
had
first
the right
five
response.
Minutes.
You had
like
the correct
first
response.
5 minutes. And I was like, oh no, I don't want to watch. This is not fun. Turn off movie. And then my wife was the one who was like, oh no, that movie's great. Like, you should actually watch it and sit through it. And I'm like, okay. And I really am glad I did, because I love it. I think it's a great movie. But it's definitely not for everybody. Like, I think in a way, maybe out of all the episodes we've done so far, is similar, not at all, but in a way, to The Paperboy, where it's like, The Paperboy, I get why someone wouldn't want to watch that, because there's some rough stuff in there that's not for everybody. Like, a lot of people are sensitive, or you don't even have to be sensitive. Like, this movie goes all out. Like, Rules of Attraction really goes for it, that you don't even have to be sensitive and you can be offended and turned off by this movie, for sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So we're going to, I think we're going to put that stuff at the back of this, because there's a lot of really good stuff to talk about with this film. So if you're listening to this now and you're like, wait a second, I tuned in because I wanted to hear them take this film on for what's negative about it. Stick around. We'll get to that. But first, there's so much that's so good about this movie that is worth talking about. Let's dig into some of that, because I think that's part of what makes it a great film. If we think it's a great film, then the way that you get people to spend time with these difficult ideas and difficult actions is that you have to make a great movie with awesome scenes that take you from one horrible thing to the next and keep you engaged. So
yes.
Let's talk about some of those. I have a list of several things here, but why don't you start?
I mean, like, right off the bat, just like the style is really seductive and great. Like, it's a very stylish movie, not just with like the use of like music from the 80s and stuff, but just like the way the story's told. There's parts that are backwards. That it's like they're having a lot of fun with the camera work here, and a lot of way of how they tell the story, and in a classic, I guess we can say, Roger Avary-esque way, which he's only made a few movies. You have all these great little scenes with characters that are only in that scene, very much like Pulp Fiction, very much like Tarantino stuff, and it's great. So like one of the early ones is you have a junkie played by little Fred Savage. Yeah. And it's the only scene he's in, right? I think.
Yeah.
And it's him just shooting heroin up, looking terrible. And it's such a smart, fun move to put, you know, little Fred Savage in that we know from like The Wonder Years and Princess Bride. And you don't want to see him shoot up heroin, much like you wouldn't want to see your own son shoot up heroin if he went off to college.
Sometimes a minute will last like an hour, you know, or other times an hour just zips by in like a minute. It's all subjective. And every person, you know, perceives it different. It's like, that's why you can't trust clocks, you know. You notice I don't have any clocks in my room, because they interfere with your ability to adjust the time to suit your needs, you know.
Mark?
Do not be a slave to time, my friend, because there's no point. Ooh. Ooh. Oh. feel my dick. I can feel my dick. Oh, oof. Oh my God.
And it makes the scene all the more effective and strangely funny, which a lot of these scenes are.
I can feel my dick. I can feel my dick. That's Fred Savage's line. I'll probably drop it in here. It's weird. Can you imagine sort of intercutting, because he's doing the scene in bed, and you could totally intercut that scene with the stuff from Princess Bride.
Oh, so no, poor Peter Falk.
Peter Falk is talking, is trying to talk to him, and Fred Savage is doing his
can
sort
feel
of
my dick.
Colonel Kurtz, like.
So yeah. that scene is great. One, you go. I don't want to just talk it. What you go?
Okay.
There's
well,
so many.
Well, okay then. Well, let's talk about the scene. This is a scene that is very, very similar to a scene in the book. A scene with Paul Williams, the great Paul Williams, shows up as the doctor in a scene where. So Paul, the one of our main three characters, Paul and his sort of group of. Sort of gay friends at college. He's about to go out on what he hopes is going to be a date. And then he gets a call that one of them, played by Jay Baruchel, in a very, that's how to pronounce his name, right?
I think that's right. Baruchel?
Baruchel. Yeah. And he has supposedly OD'd, but he's probably just passed out from being drunk, and it's ruining Paul's day. Or ruining Paul's evening, but he goes along with them, and then they go to drop him off at the emergency room where they're met by Paul Williams. And you know, I'll just drop the scene in here because it's so good.
Sorry, there's nothing more I can do here.
You have to do something. I've seen his honey art. Please fix him.
Harry's gone bye-bye. Harry's gone to the big bye-bye. He's got his name in the papers on the backside. It's toe tag time in Teenville tonight, again.
Teenville?
You should have just said no, Harry.
I'm not dead, am I?
Ah.
Yes, you are. Shut up.
Actually, you don't have a pulse. I think you're dead. If you let me run a few tests, I can probably
practice your buddy
that Harry is dead.
You don't know what you're talking about.
You like that?
Come on.
You test on Harry.
No.
I'm sure I can prove he's dead.
No.
I must insist you bring back your friend's corpse for me to do some tests.
And so at the end of that scene, he's just like, that ending there is Paul Williams' addition or Roger Avary's addition. It's even funnier. It's so much funnier in the film than in the book.
And there's just something mischievous about Paul Williams in this part. And is that like, he's really good at doing that. Like in Phantom of the Paradise, he's good because he's such a tiny little man. There's something like impish about him, like playing a prank, like just fucking with these guys and like clearly having a good time. And it's so good.
Yes. But we have to talk about the best scene in this movie.
Oh, God.
The scene that if this, it's like, yeah, go on.
It's the best. It's maybe the best scene of like any movie. And like so it's later on in the movie, and like if you're turned off by this movie, at least sit through it long enough to get to this part. Or if you have a DVD, just skip to this part, I guess. But it's so Paul goes to meet his mother, played by Faye Dunaway. And brilliantly played by Faye Dunaway, and they're meeting sort of like a family friend. I think it's the mom's friend, and so the mom's friend played by Swoosie Kurtz, and then Swoosie Kurtz's son Richard played by Russell Sams, and it starts innocently enough, I guess, with Richard and Paul just dancing in their underwear, singing George Michael's Faith on the bed, while the two moms are getting drunk and pilled up downstairs in the hotel bar/restaurant. And then, so this, I don't know who this Russell Sams guy, I don't know where he came from or where he went, but this is like such a star power, like such a great role. Like it reminds me of something that like a Robert Downey Jr. would have been able to pull off like in the 80s. And it's just like a powerhouse where he just like is at this dinner with them or lunch and just saying the most inappropriate stuff, not giving a fuck what his parents think, what his friend thinks, what the people in the restaurant think. And it's just like, it's a 3-minute, 4-minute scene. And then it ends with him just telling everyone to fuck off, just fuck you to everybody. And then he's out the movie. It's just like when Daffy Duck shows up in a Looney Tunes cartoon and just fucks it up and then leaves. It's very similar to that. And like this, it's amazing.
Yeah. The stand, I mean, it's Paul, the character of Paul is supposed to seem out of place and just come, but the actor seems completely like left in the dust by the three people across the table from him. Between Faye Dunaway and Swoosie Kurtz doing this like sort of like pilled up female Laurel and Hardy bit that they're doing, their reactions are so fucking great. They're just so real and so perfect, and then they have so much to react to. In Russell Sam's doing, yeah, I just he should this should be in every movie. This scene should be in every movie. Like, the Daffy Duck thing is perfect. Russell Sands should interrupt every fucking movie that's ever been made.
And, like, the world is wrong about Russell Sands. Like, this should, like, he should have been the big star out of this movie.
Oh, my God.
Like, I love J. Baruchel. I love, you know, I think, like, James Vanderbeek can be good. Jessica Biel's fine. But, like, why didn't this make Russell Sands, like, a name that we know who's in movies? Like, let's bring him back wherever he is. I'm guessing TV hell or wherever. Just like, let's put him in some fucking movies. Like, he's like, I don't know how they knew that this guy could do this, because it's such, because the whole role, the whole scene relies so heavily on this character, like, selling this and kind of taking over. And then, like, it's a character you don't see before or after this scene. And they just pulled this actor in, and he just hits a home run like most actors dream of.
Yeah.
You know? And this was the moment when I was like, okay, this movie has won me over. As much as I'm disturbed and angry at a lot of this movie, I'm so glad that I saw this scene in a movie. And so, is this in the book?
The scene is in the book. And I'll say, for like, that's, it's good that it's there. I mean, it's good that it's in the movie, because we're going to get into it. Some of the ways that this film gets de-gayed is questionable, but it's nice that they have this really just super, super gay scene in a way that is like, it's the best scene in the movie. It makes, whether or not you like it, I'm not sure that I would fit in the room dancing along with them, but I felt invited into that room, and I would like to be jumping it down on that bed, dancing along to Faith. And then you see this guy who is so macho-ly gay. Like, he's being the most aggressively gay character you could possibly be without any, there's nothing fey about it. He is so young and proud of his gayness. Fuck you, Mom. Like, it's God, it's so good. It makes gay look so attractive. Like, I want to be that confident as that guy. I want to be able to have that much swagger in any situation. It's so good. And yeah, he went on, he was in Wonderland, which I need to see. It's on my list of things to see. So maybe the combination of the Rules of Attraction and Wonderland was just a little bit too much for his career in the millennium.
What's Wonderland?
It's about it's the one about what's his name? The porn star.
The John Holmes. Is that the one
Val
with
Kilmer's John Holmes?
Oh. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
okay.
Yeah. Maybe that's another film for The World is Wrong at some point. It seems very World is Wrong-y.
Well, let's go into some of the differences with the book, because I didn't read the book, because I'm an idiot who only watches movies. But you at least listened to the book on tape.
Yeah.
Who reads the book on tape? Who's the person who reads it?
It's a man and a woman. I don't have their names, but one thing that's really okay. Spoiler alert, people! If you haven't seen the movie, I'm going to divulge a very important plot point. I hope you've seen the movie. If you haven't, skip ahead. I think it's just one actor and one actress, but when the woman reading all the female voices reads the voice of the girl who kills herself, her voice sounds exactly like Miranda July doing the voice of the doomed cat in the future.
How long is 30 days? It was turning out to be a little bit longer than, say, for example, the day after tomorrow.
The feeling is neither icy nor hot. Yet there is still no in-between. Just this bland pulse that fixates in my body at any given time of the day. I have decided to put notes in his box every day. I imagine him pinning these notes somewhere, perhaps pinned to a white wall in his room, a room I wish to live in.
It's so odd because they're very similar characters.
Yeah.
Similarly doomed. It's almost like, if I didn't know that it was Miranda July who did the voice of the cat, I'd be like, well, maybe they just got that actress to come in and do it for just that. But there's no way they got Miranda July to come in and read a part of the rules of attraction.
You know, you never know, like, you know, who shows up to read these things. It's like probably an easy paycheck. I don't know.
No, I'm just...
Pay for that next indie movie. Do a Bret Easton Ellis book.
After everything we've just said about the rules of attraction, do you think Miranda July... No. Is going to lend her talents to playing.
No.
No. I just feel like, oh, maybe it's just like, maybe that's like the Tom Waits voice for women. Like everyone can do some version.
Everyone can do some version of this.
You know, like everyone can do some version of the I'm a little cat voice. Let's talk about some of the differences because.
I'm interested.
Okay. So. First of all, let's talk about some of the similarities. So one of the things, the book is just a series of monologues. It's all these people's inner monologues. And what's great about it is hearing it's sort of a Rashomon thing where two different characters will talk about the same situation and you realize how disconnected they are. And so that's... That's one of the things that the film does really well is grabbing all of these monologues, like the monologue of the character who goes to Europe.
That part is so good.
Yeah. And I guess that they made that into its own movie, right?
Yeah. So it's a scene in the movie where it's this character played by Kit Pardue. He goes on like a Euro vacation, like 2-3 weeks in Europe. But it's him just spouting so quickly, like everything he did, everybody he met, everywhere he went, and the movie just moves at this breakneck speed and almost like fast motion. And it's fast in some parts, and I guess they shot so much, clearly they had to cram all this fast stuff in, that they made. There's a movie that exists called Glitterati that is credited to Roger Avary as director. That is just the documentary about that, and I guess it's never been released, and you have to like. Ask Roger Avary to show it to you at a party, or you know, I think Bret Easton Ellis probably has a copy. And Bret Easton Ellis was like, "No one will ever see this movie. We don't know the legalities of showing because I guess it's like a lot of sex and a lot of just like who knows if they got written consent from anyone to be in this movie." I would like to see it sometime. Somehow, it sounds interesting, but yeah. But you said that's pretty much like in the book.
So that monologue is almost exactly as it is in the book.
Great.
And much better in the film at least on the book on the tape, because they did it so fast. In the book, they read it. The guy reads it a little bit slower. And so there's that, and just the way that they use there are ways that Avary captures the tone of the book. And actually, I think the film is, there's parts where the book just drags. Like it's better to spend 2 hours with these people than 12 hours with these people.
Yeah. Can imagine.
I think. So, but let's get into some of the, I think, less great changes. So, again, spoiler alerts, people. We're gonna be talking about very specifics of the film. So if you, I hope you've watched it and that you're along with us for this. But if not, you might want to skip ahead or wait until you've watched it to listen to this part. So, first off, the film begins at the end of the world party. Begins at the end, which is part of one of Avery's additions to have it be building up to this night when all this bad stuff happens. And then we go back and see how we got there. That's not what this is. That's not the book at all. And one of the biggest changes they make is the character of Lauren, who is portrayed in the film as a virgin who looks at pictures of venereal disease to keep from having sex as she pines for Victor to come home from Europe. In the book, she's not a virgin. She has many relationships at college, including one with Sean Bateman, where he falls in love with her and she kind of sees him as like a doofus hot boy toy. And so, and then in the film, they make her into a virgin who gets raped and vomited on at the end of the movie by a guy who's talking about Quentin Tarantino. And all of that feels very much like a Roger Avary invention. And I am troubled by the need to make her into... Oh, and she's also blonde in the book, which doesn't really matter, except that it sort of goes to what I think is one of just Roger Avery's things for like short-haired, you know, French new wavy looking, dark-haired girls. But then the fact of making her a virgin and making her get raped and defiled in a movie where that's not at all in the book seems...
So what is she like in the book? Is she more like empowered?
In the book, she's a lot more like... In the book, she's a lot more like Sean Bateman. In fact, Sean Bateman in the book is not portrayed as a scary sociopath at all, but just sort of like a drugged up, hot loser, you know, who...
Do you think they changed him because of the popularity of American Psycho? They were like, oh, we got to make him kind of like because he's the brother. So we got to make him like a creepy, almost murderer type in the way his personality is. I wonder if that was if American Psycho wasn't a movie, if that would have been changed.
I wonder. I mean, there's just a lot. The film was these dynamics. So the two big things that were changed were that they've made Lauren into a virgin who is not carrying on a relationship with like in the book, she's had a relationship with Paul and Victor and Sean. She does not have any kind of relationship with her professor. That's also added with Eric Stoltz making her, you know, give him a blowjob for good grades. That is another addition to the film, which is not in the book. In fact, in the book, Sean Bateman is jealous of the professor, even though the professor is portrayed as being obviously not a threat to him in any way. So again, it's more, there's all these ways that Sean Bateman becomes a lot more pathetic in the book, and in this he's the scary, sexy, dangerous guy. And then also in the book, he and Paul have a sexual relationship. In the movie, Paul pines for Sean Bateman and is unrequited. In the book, they have a relationship. Paul pines for a real relationship with Sean. And in Sean's inner monologue, he doesn't even address the relationship. So, like, you have this great thing in the book where in Sean's inner monologue, he thinks that he and Lauren are involved in a great love affair. And Lauren sees him as, like, just a phase she's going through. And in the book, Paul sees he and Sean as having a great love affair. And Sean sees Paul kind of the way that Lauren sees Sean. And that if he had made that movie, it might not have been as fun to watch in some ways as the, like, he flattered me in a certain way. Like, I feel like this film was aimed at white straight guys like me, but it feels really like it excluded the actual interesting lives, and it makes Paul and Lauren into just people who are reacting to Sean Bateman as opposed to.
Yeah.
And then if you at the very end of the film, like if you think about it, there's a scene at the end where Lauren and Paul are standing together and watching Sean Bateman ride off on his motorcycle. And that ending makes so much more sense to the book than to these two people, one who's just been raped and vomited on, and one who's just been gay panicked and beaten up by a football player.
Yeah.
And then they walk out and have this soulful moment that
totally
rings hollow, but it makes sense.
It really does.
In the book.
Yeah. It really is weird in the movie because you're like, don't these people have better things to be thinking about right now? Like these awful things that happened to them as opposed to pining for their friend who's driving away. Like that does definitely feels like, why is this what they're thinking about? Right? It doesn't quite work for sure. Is it like a fantasy sequence? Like there is a scene where Sean and Paul kiss, right?
Yeah. Where
is that like a dream?
In the movie, it goes to split screen. So they go up to their room and they're hanging out.
Right.
And then Paul puts a pillow over his crotch. And basically we get the idea that he's masturbating and thinking.
And he's thinking about it. Yeah.
And then he looks at Sean. And so they have a scene in the movie where Sean Bateman and Paul kiss.
But why didn't they go for it?
But then they cut to Paul, to Sean being asleep and Paul just being like, oh, darn, he's straight.
Yeah. And they only allude, they allude to this kind of misconception of the relationship only through like, there's a part where Sean is like, hey, let's go get, where they agree to go get like burritos or something, enchiladas or some meal. And then clearly by the end of the day, Sean's completely forgotten about it and wasn't even listening to begin with. And Paul kind of thought like, oh, I thought we were going to go on like a date or something. And again, I wonder if all these changes with these other characters are because, like, if American Psycho wasn't such a big deal as a movie, like, right before this, if they wouldn't have leaned so heavily into making Sean, like, the main guy and these other people just sort of reacting and interacting with him as a character. Like, if that movie hadn't happened, would it have all been an equal playing field for these characters? I wonder.
I mean, there's a lot of things you could ask. I mean, you could ask if this film had been directed by a woman, would it have been?
Or if it had been directed
by
someone
who was comfortable with gay stuff, you know?
And the movie American Psycho is directed by a woman. And that book is really violent towards women and really disgusting and like shocking. But because a lady directed the movie, it's tasteful. It's not distasteful. Whereas definitely this movie feels a little distasteful at times, a lot of time, for sure.
So let's get into like talking about some of the horrific aspects of those. This is where, for me, where the horror comes in and where I feel both drawn into and indicted by it. Because, okay, like I said, so my initial reaction to this film was, oh, this is a really honest film about some really ugly stuff, and I'm glad it's dealing with it, and it's also really entertaining. And then sort of realizing after reading the book that it's entertaining because it was tuned to my tastes at the expense of other people's tastes and lives, and if you think about how much things have changed in Hollywood just since 2002, and you imagine what it must have been like for some of these actresses on the set, for anyone who was gay on the set, to anyone who was a fan of the book and maybe related to the other two characters. It's just the aesthetic, and knowing that this was Weinstein wasn't involved in this, but he's definitely a part of the Roger Avary story. And he's just that, like, Harvey Weinstein wasn't the only purveyor of that idea and that aesthetic. That was sort of, it was pervasive in Hollywood, this idea of, we've basically, it's just so, it's something about, the hardest part for me is the idea you take this character, this woman who was kind of the most powerful of these three characters, and you make her like you de-sex her, and then you de-sex her as a person and make her a virgin, but you amp up the sex in the most awful ways. It'll make, she's forced to give a blowjob. She's a virgin who's forced to give the blowjob to this professor, and he's like, I hear you give great blowjobs. Like, who is this person who's a virgin reading the, you know, the venereal disease manual, who also has a reputation for giving great blowjobs to professors? Yeah. Only in the mind of, like, of Harvey Weinstein and Roger Avary and men who succeeded in that system. And to me, the horror is imagining what it was like to be someone like Jessica Biel, who, again, her character she gets drunk and goes and has sex or gets raped by the whole football team. Another addition by Roger Avary to this. And to be, to imagine what it was like to be a woman on that set at that time, that just seems, that's where the horror lives for me. But one of the things that made me think of, and why I'm excited to talk to you about this, is because you were in Hollywood pitching films right around this time. And I remember you talking to me about your experience. And this is not just horrifying for women. When you please tell your experience, because I think it's really important.
It's more horrifying to women. I'm okay. But
definitely.
It's just a sad thing about, you know, when you deal with it, I'm sure this is the same with the music industry. When you deal with something with this much money involved and this much, you know, people with power, they abuse their power and they do gross things with it. You know, that's just the sad thing that comes with power and money. And I've had, you know, my writing partner Zach and I had a meeting where we were pitching. Well, I have a few stories. I can go on forever. It's sad. There's a lot of creepy dudes in charge of making movies. We were pitching a movie about a man and a woman working together, basically. Like, they had a job to do together. And they were on a trip together. And this guy, this was an agent we were interviewing for. And guess what? He didn't become our agent. But he was like, why aren't they having sex? Why aren't they having sex together? I'm like, well, what do you mean? That doesn't make sense. Like, they just work together. Like, haven't you read the script? And he's like, a man and a woman can't be in the same room and they're not going to want to have sex with each other. And like, he's going to check out her ass and this is going to happen. And we're like, no, this is not going to happen. Like, no, this is not in this movie. This is not, these people just work together. And then he came to this conclusion of, oh, I get it. She's supposed to be a fat lady. And we're like, what? No. Like, well, I mean, you could be played by whoever, but that's not why he's not having sex with her. And he got stuck. He couldn't get around it in his mind. And then we also wrote another movie where we had these two lesbian characters in it. And they, again, are just friends. They actually aren't even dating each other. And they go through this whole ordeal. And the guy didn't understand. It's like, well, why? This is a different guy. This is a different producer. I'm not saying any names. And he was like, well, she's tough because she got raped, right? Like, we should have a scene where she gets raped to show how tough she is. And we're like, no, that's like that doesn't happen to Rambo. Like, why? Like you don't expect Stallone has to be tough because he got raped. Like, that's such a weird thing for women characters to go through in movies. Of like, oh, you're tough because a man did something really bad to you. Like, that's offensive. And this is just like people in charge of these movies are... can be real creep sometimes. It's definitely towards women.
Yeah. Yeah. And having, so that's the horror. That's the horror, people, is that Hollywood and like these people in power who, I think that's, it's odd because the film, and this is why I think it's a useful conversation, is because the film, I feel like the film's relationship to the book is like the characters in the book's relationship to each other. Like, they just don't get each other. Like, they, the fact that Roger Avary read this book, surveyed, and made a, like, again, I think made a great movie, but the changes that he made reveal some really, you know, just ugly, you know, prejudices, inclinations as to what, like just sort of like that. Like, she has to be a virgin. Like, no one will believe, no one will care about her if she's sleeping around. We need to make her a virgin who gets raped, and then people will care about this character.
Yeah, I wonder if he based it on like, oh, I knew someone in college where this happened to, so I'm going to change it to this, or Yeah, yeah. Or like, yeah, I wonder if he was trying to put his own experience, like not saying that he did anything bad to anyone, but just saying like maybe he had friends or knew people of like, oh, she has to be a virgin because I knew a virgin that at a party such and such. You know, like it's possible.
Well, yeah,
that's where it came from.
Whether it's that or go on.
Or he was just like at the time reading through news stories and be like, here's all other awful things that happen in college that aren't in the book. I want to update it for 2002 and add all these other things that maybe Bret Easton Ellis didn't, you know, write about back then and should have or shouldn't have. You know,
I wish it had just been he had just realized halfway through that he should have just been making the Russell Sams dick movie. Gone and
yeah.
That's the guy they should have made a separate movie with.
Now, so is this movie more shocking and full of shocking stuff than the book? Because, I mean, Bret Easton Ellis can write a shocking book. With like American Psycho, the book is definitely way more upsetting than the movie.
I would say there's almost nothing shocking in the way that this movie is shocking about the book. This is what... If you made a more honest adaptation of this book, it wouldn't be as good a movie, I think. I think someone could make a good version of this book and make different choices than the movie made and still make it a good movie. You could do the inclination to amp up some of the dramatic parts of it, like the way that he sets up this, like the suicide has way more impact in the book, in the movie than in the book. And I think that makes it stronger. Mm-hmm. The Russell Sam scene gets better. The Paul Williams scene gets better. It's just, actually having the music in it and as opposed to them talking about the music. It's just, he does a lot of things that the movie does well. I think that especially even now, as we're talking about it, the way that the Lauren character is manipulated by the film into all these different things that actually just she doesn't make sense. If you're watching the film and relating to her, you're going to have such a cognitively dissonant experience of what you're supposed to be feeling or thinking. And, I related somewhat to I was a guy who was in Hollywood and in high school and knew a lot of gay people who I didn't know were gay. And then later on, they've told me that they had crushes on me and I was oblivious to it. And so I related to that aspect of what's in the movie. And but then realizing again, what the movie did to like, in order to make it so that I could relate to it, it totally betrayed Paul who just think about it. Two of the three scenes that we talked about as being the greatest scenes in the movie were his scenes.
Yeah.
Right. The Paul Williams scene and the New York stuff is all Paul's story. Yeah. His story is actually the most interesting in the book and it gets completely ripped out from under him. And I feel like that actor could have, he's a compelling actor. And if that film had gone a different way and given him a little bit more than being a punchline, I think it would have been a better, it could have been a better movie. But let's, now there's more here because of Roger Avary, because, you're a big Tarantino fan and I am as well, but I count on you to be the Tarantino scholar and Roger Avary is definite, like in this movie, he starts off by having one of his characters reference Tarantino as a director who was only the executive producer on something and shouldn't actually be getting credit for it because it's not really a Tarantino film, which if you're the guy who co-wrote Pulp Fiction is a pretty, direct.
Yeah. And you put that at the beginning of your movie is a bold move.
Yeah.
And then make that character
a rapist on top of it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's definitely sticking the knife in and twisting it. And I can't speak to what Avery and Tarantino's relationship is like now. I have no idea. But I know that they knew each other long ago. They worked together at the same video store, I believe. I think that's the story of how they became friends. And they decided they were going to make a movie, like an anthology movie,
because they wanted to make a movie where each of them wrote and directed, and then a third person would write and direct like a short and make a feature, like an omnibus sort of movie, like a New York Stories. And that movie got scrapped, and the first story, which was Tarantino's, ended up becoming Reservoir Dogs. And the story that was Roger Avary's ended up being the Butch, the Bruce Willis part of Pulp Fiction. And that's and then Roger Avary supposedly had many conversations about Pulp Fiction and added stuff to it, which is why he gets a writing credit, even though I think Tarantino actually wrote the script of Pulp Fiction. I think Avary came up with so much of the ideas, which is why he shared the credit and got the Oscar with Tarantino. And I think it's the only time Tarantino ever shared a writing credit with anybody, ever. Was with that, maybe to avoid a lawsuit.
drop in the quote from Gabriel Byrne from Mad.
which quote?
This is the last time I ever share a stage with anyone. From now on, I'm doing a single.
Where he's like, this is the last time I share a stage with anyone.
But, I mean, they were still cool back then. I mean, and Roger Avary's first movie, Killing Zoe, I believe came out, like, right before Pulp Fiction or at the same time. And Tarantino did produce that. And I remember at the time that movie kind of being pushed by people as, like, this is a Tarantino movie. And maybe that's what the reference is in that, being like, he produced it. He didn't make it. And maybe he's kind of, Avary, a little bitter that Tarantino got a little credit for Killing Zoe, which is a great first movie. Like, that's another movie the world is wrong about. And I think in general, the world is kind of wrong about Avary as a filmmaker, because I think he's only made three movies, I think four maybe. He made a TV movie, I think, in there. But, like, he's really good in terms of, like, you know, style and, like, capturing, like, a very captivating movie. And he's not really talked about. Like, no one really groups him in with any of the other filmmakers from the 90s or even the aughts. He's just sort of, like, still thought of as an afterthought of Pulp Fiction, which I'm sure is not fun for him. He's definitely, like, mentioned with Tarantino usually, and it's not, like, kind of thought of as his own person. But, I mean, you haven't seen Killing Zoe, but you saw his latest movie,
yeah,
right?
I saw Lucky Day, and it is a film that is very much, if he doesn't like being known as the other guy from Pulp Fiction, then he probably shouldn't be massively referencing Pulp Fiction. He has a character who is called Honey Bun over and over and over again in this movie. And again, it's another short cropped hair French. It's like the character from the Butch scene in Pulp. Like, it's the same. She has the same haircut as Lauren.
He likes what he likes.
So
he's like, he's a Russ Meyer of short hair. Yeah. You know, he knows what he likes with a lady and sticks with it.
Yeah, he wants it all to be Gene Seberg in Breathless.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is nothing wrong. I guess there's nothing wrong with that. But yeah, so so Lucky Day, is a very enjoyable film. It has some interesting inventions. If he's trying to get away from Pulp Fiction, then the film is way too obsessed with Pulp Fiction. But as someone who gets the endorphin rush out of recognizing things, the fact that he does it, that he rings that bell so much,
yeah,
is kind of fun and makes it feel like, okay, you're a bitter little guy. I can relate to that. I'm a bitter little guy. You might even win me over. And also, I should reference, what is his name? The actor. I wrote it in my notes. Hold on a second. Oh, so the actor Clifton Collins Jr., who plays the drug dealer in Rules of Attraction,
he's great.
A great role as a parole officer in Lucky Day. And you can tell that just Roger Avary loves this guy. The drug dealer scenes also the drug dealer scenes are in the book, but they do, again, don't have the same impact. This movie, Pulp Fiction's those up a lot. And makes them, again, it gives the movie a drive that it doesn't have. The book just doesn't feel like, it's not really going anywhere. It's just giving you pictures of these people. So Avery did have the difficult job of having to make it into a movie with a plot. And so this, you know, Vanderbeek needing to get the money and all of that stuff, you know, because he's a drug dealer and he has to, that's why he's talking to Fred Savage to try and get his money. And these drug dealers are going to beat him up if he doesn't get it. And that gives the film some sense of narrative drive that it wouldn't have otherwise.
And those parts do feel very Tarantino-esque. I mean, they feel kind of like the guy who made Pulp Fiction.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's Candace. It's like either he's like leaning into it to remind us, like, see, I helped make that great movie too. You don't talk about me. Or he just can't help himself. He's like, this is just how, it's like Wes Anderson with the wallpaper. I can't help but be me, and this is how I make movies. Even if I'm trying to escape Pulp Fiction, keeps pulling me back.
So before we wrap this up, let's, we haven't really talked about the main cast. I think that the casting of Vanderbeek is obviously the most interesting piece of this.
Yeah, and I think, and like the Fred Savage scene, I think it is kind of stunt casting in a way, where it's just like, look at this guy that we all loved from Dawson's Creek, and let's watch him punch a lady in the face. And you're like, oh, okay, like I wasn't expecting James Vanderbeek to do that. So it does feel a little like, and you can tell with his performance, he's like, I don't normally play dark, but I'm going to play it dark. I think he does a pretty good job. I was kind of surprised. Like, that was the one thing going into this movie. I'm like, James Vanderbeek, I don't know, like, Varsity Blues guy. Like, but I think he does a pretty, I think he does a really good job. I think, like, he definitely hams it up more than anyone in this movie other than Russell Sams. But, like, he definitely is playing, like, I'm troubled, like, in the way he just even looks, like, in this, just his face, you know, without even saying anything. He's definitely playing that up, and I wonder if that was the direction of Roger Avary, or if he in his mind was like, oh, I'm supposed to be the brother of the American Psycho guy, so I'm gonna be my own version of a sinister, scary guy. I don't know.
Yeah, I've generally thought that one of the things, even before I had read the book and realized the changes and had an opportunity to go from loving the film to being offended by it, and then having to contend with what that says to me about me. I've also, just from a pure film fan stance, I've always thought, God, if that film had starred, like, Vanderbeek is good, but if it had starred someone more like a Christian Bale, like an equivalent of someone who had gone on, who was a real movie star. Like, Vanderbeek was a TV star who just, like, it's the Steve McQueen thing. It's more like the Leonardo DiCaprio thing from Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. It's the guy who couldn't make the transition from TV to films. But if they had got a more compelling actor in that role, I feel like the film would be, people would like, people, here's one way, one of the ways that I think maybe the world is wrong about this film. People who are judgmental about the toxic aspects of this film, if they liked the actor who was in the lead, I think people would be more willing to accept to those.
Yeah.
If it was a DiCaprio, like, or a Christian Bale.
Jake Gyllenhaal.
Jake Gyllenhaal would be perfect. Like, this, if they had the guy from Donnie Darko, because this is right around Donnie Darko, if he had been in this, I feel like, well, maybe I would feel like the film would have been smarter anyway, but to put him in it. But I think that if it had been the exact same film, I think people who like that actor would be more okay with some of the shitty stuff that happens in this movie. And so, I think people just, I think one of the things that's strong about this movie is that if you watch it from the standpoint of just judging it, then you're going to miss out on it. If you watch it from the standpoint of judging yourself and just like, and it as a reflection of things and dynamics that a lot of us are complicit in, even not actively, that it makes you think and it about where in your life you've been at a party where some shit went down and you weren't doing the shit, but you were at the party and maybe you even didn't know about that it was going down. But on some level, you knew that it wasn't like 100% cool some other thing that was going on, and how do all of these little things build up to something that's monumentally dangerous and shitty. I think that's, and the fact that the movie does that, and it's, it draws you in, even though, going back to Vanderbeek, he's not the most compelling lead, is again huge strength for the movie.
And I wonder too if the reason why the gay content was toned down, like his relationship, was because of him being in it, because there was that Todd Solondz movie Storytelling, which I think came out right before this, and so, and that's an anthology movie with two stories, but originally it was supposed to be three, and I think how I remember, I mean it might be totally wrong factually, but I seem to recall hearing that the third part was going to be about a gay, like a football player who ends up in some sort of gay relationship or gay circumstances, whatever, I don't know what it is. And it was played by James Vanderbeek, and supposedly like his people or just the studio was like, yeah, we can't have him, like we can't have this up-and-coming actor be a part of this gay thing. And I wonder if this was left over from that sort of stuff, where it's like, okay, you can have him kiss him, but it's got to be a dream. You know, like I wonder... I mean, I'm not saying that James Vanderbeek's people did this. It's very possible, but I do remember hearing that rumor about that storytelling movie.
Yeah. Yeah. It's, you know, they say it, it takes a village to create a toxic village. And again, I think that's probably, if you want to feel the real horror of this film, you got to look at the big picture on it. And a lot of the things that are ugly about this film were attractive in 2002, were considered attractive by a lot of people. You know, whether that's gay panic, or whether that's, you know, non-consensual sex, or whether that's James Vanderbeek.
And it's interesting, like, yeah, it's interesting too, going back to how the world is wrong about this, of like I think you get caught up in the style of it, and you tend to gloss over some of the upsetting things, like the people that like it. I mean, I'm not saying this was me when I liked it, but like I think some people get caught up in the style, and you're not, and you don't tend to pause to question the upsetting things. Like this happens in a lot of movies. Like, I mean, you can even argue that the Pulp Fiction is that way, of like, I'm having a good time, it's fun, and you're not thinking like, oh, they just shot that guy's face off, you know, like, why is this fun? But it is. And I like, and it's, I think it is interesting with this movie that Roger Avary took a movie like Pulp Fiction. It's about a different bunch of characters, and it's violent and it's upsetting, but it's kind of grounded a little more in reality than Pulp Fiction. Like Pulp Fiction is definitely more in a fantasy world. Like it does, like there's no part of Pulp Fiction where like, oh, this is reality. Whereas this movie is a little more grounded in reality. It's still a movie, so it has, you know, made up stuff. But like, it is interesting to be like, I'm going to make a fun movie, but have it be more real and a little more upsetting than even Pulp Fiction could be. And people will still like it.
Yeah.
Or really hate it. Like, yeah. I don't know. But yeah, it's all very interesting.
Well, I did a little, since, if you don't want to read the Bret Easton Ellis novel or take the time to listen to the book on tape, I've done a little work for you, and I figured out how to fix this film. Even without changing a frame of it, you just have to think of it as two ways. One, Lauren is lying to her roommate. She is actually a horn dog who's fucking all over campus, and she's only mind fucking with her roommate, Jessica Biel, because she's so much smarter than she is. And she actually wants her to hook up with James Vanderbeek. She is actually controlling this whole situation. And in order for that to happen, you have to imagine that her kink is being filmed having in awful, weird, degrading sex scenes. But she also orchestrated that just to fuck with Vanderbeek. And then you also have to imagine that the fantasy scene, which we are told is a fantasy scene in the movie, is actually the real movie. And we're seeing the movie through Vanderbeek's totally in denial, character,
which he does
not is not acknowledging that he is in the middle of a gay relationship with Paul Denton. And if you watch the movie with those just thinking of it those two ways, that Sean is wrong and he is actually having an affair with Paul Denton and in denial about it, and Lauren is lying and is actually really is orchestrating all of this, I think the movie then gets a lot better.
And that ending makes more sense then as to why they just be totally fine and being like, goodbye. Like, and why it doesn't seem like anything bad happened. It's like they are totally okay with it. Yeah. Oh, and speaking of the end, I love movies where the end credits go in reverse. I'm such a sucker for that. And again, that's another Pulp Fiction sort of thing, because that's like the first time that was in a movie was Kiss Me Deadly, I think. And that was the opening credits of Kiss Me Deadly, which of course has the glowing, you know, like suitcase, which is of course in Pulp Fiction. Other great movies with end credits that go backwards. Seven, I think, does that. Repo Man, one of my favorite movies. Like, I'm a sucker for reverse end credits scroll.
Okay, well, movie makers, if you want to win Bryan over, you know how to do it now.
Great. Well, I don't know. Is there anything else? I feel we've really gutted this movie out like a Patrick Bateman.
Yeah, I'm. this was a challenging one. So let's get a little bit meta about this. So just because I like to be transparent with the audience. So this is the only one of these that we went back and re-recorded. And it's because we're trying to figure out how to be an extremely positive podcast and also be critical of the films that we love. And it's a fine balance. But did you want to speak to that at all, Bryan? I know I'm putting you on the spot, but you've probably thought about it a fair
I think the first time we did it, we got so bogged down with all the stuff that bothered us that we forgot that we picked it in the first place because we did like this movie. So we had to go back and be like, wait a minute, how do we talk about, like, we like this movie, but it is about, and I guess in a way that is the conundrum of this movie in general is like, yeah, like it's a turnoff. Like it's a gross movie. Like it's about terrible people doing awful things. It's not for everybody. If you have a trigger, baby, this movie probably hits that trigger, you know, like, and, but it's a good movie and it's like good art. It's like, you know, it's spawned a conversation and it's not all art is pleasant and this is definitely not a pleasant piece of art, but it doesn't mean it's bad. It means it could, maybe that makes it even better because it made us think and talk about it as opposed to some movie that's about great people doing great things, us winning World War II again or whatever. That's just a total snooze fest and has no conversation to be had with it.
Yeah, yeah. And I hope people get the idea that when I say that this is an extremely positive podcast called The World is Wrong, that there's an inherent irony and humor in it that says that we are, the whole point of our show is negative, is to say that you're wrong, but it's positive because the thing you're wrong about is something that isn't hurting anybody. Well, maybe Rules of Attraction hurt some people, but if it did it a while ago. There's nothing we can do about it now, but there's still, except maybe make it worthwhile. Like they stormed the beaches of this. People died storming the beaches of Rules of Attraction. The least we can do is honor them and their sacrifice by watching the movie. Jessica Biel is awesome in this movie. It's a tough part.
She is.
And she's great in it. And I have just a feeling that people probably don't give her, like, I just have to believe she suffered to make this film in the environment that she was in and the way that her character was used. And she's awesome. She deserves to be honored with watching it and be feeling terrible for her and the way she's treated, but also recognizing, wow, talent. Like, wow, if they could have cast her as Sean Bateman, now that would have been a movie.
Sequel.
So we're going to, like, I guess to me, part of the idea of being extremely positive is welcoming criticism without it having to be a debate. It's like, oh, you find this movie too painful to watch? I get it. I feel the same way about Schindler's List. But I think Schindler's List should still exist as a movie, even though it hurts. And I think other people who it hurts slightly less should watch it slightly more. So I think it's totally any criticism you have of that movie or this movie or any movie is welcomed into the conversation. But as long as it's not from a standpoint of like, this movie should not exist. No one should. Your opinion of liking it is bad. Like, I think this is a perfect movie for like, this movie is a great, great movie if you just like movies. And there's so many things that are, you know, downright wrong inside of it that it raises this question. It, you know, there isn't a direct answer, but I hope we've done our, I hope we've opened up that space where other people can have equally difficult conversations about this or any other work of art and welcome criticism. And in the same sense, if you've listened to this and you have criticisms, we welcome them. We invite them to be, you know, have a little dash of humor and respect, because that's what makes it a conversation. But there's certainly, we're very open to the areas where, even though we've done our best in trying to address this film, where our privileged position or our just ignorant position became obvious to you listening to it, just as Avery's privileged and or ignorant position became evident to at least me when I was researching the film. So please write to us at contact@theworldiswrongpodcast.com. You know, post comments on our Instagram page, just to let you know, if you post on Instagram, you're more likely to get Brian Connolly. You send an email, you're more likely to get me. So he gets all the fun, exciting stuff, and I get the complaints. So send them to me.
You'll get people. You'll get the long hate mail, and I'll just get the little like heart puppy face, yes. You know, poo.
And that is as it should be. Go on.
So you no, are we done? I think we did it.
Yeah, let's talk about where people can find us.
Hey y'all, it's Amy from the Pink Among Men podcast. I know you are really, really busy with your sourdough starter and your fourth rewatch of The Office. So it's totally cool if you don't have time for an informative, perspective-bending podcast right now. But if you do have a few minutes to spare in your jam-packed schedule, I want to offer Pink Among Men for your consideration. Pink Among Men is a weekly conversation on different perspectives, gender, and marginalization in the creative community. We chat with actors from shows you watch, directors who make movies that you want to watch, and comedians from stand-up shows that you'll probably never watch, but you should. Every Wednesday, they sit down to talk about the tragedy and the triumph that comes with not being a white dude in arts and entertainment. You probably don't have time for it, but maybe subscribe so you can listen when you're a little less busy. Get Pink Among Men on Stitcher, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts. We're a proud member of the Paper House Network.
So you can find Andras on the Radio 8 Ball Show, another podcast you do, radio show. It's not fair to call it a podcast because it was a show long before podcasts were a thing.
Yeah.
It's
a show.
Right now it's a podcast because you can't leave the house, but you know.
Yes.
But the Radio 8 Ball Show. And it's a great show. I was a guest recently. You talk a lot about interesting things. You bring in the guests' lives in an interesting way. You talk about synchronicities and things that line up in your own life and just the world in general. And then they ask a question, and then you consult the pop oracle, and you get a randomly picked song to answer that deep question. And it becomes even deeper with a song answer. I love it.
Have you... now, you asked a question when you were on about... Can a song without words be an answer? And you got the song Caroline from Ian Moore. Have you had any synchronicities with Moore, Ian, Caroline, silence, music?
You know, not yet. Not that I'm such a blissfully unaware human being that I probably have, and I missed it.
Well, you have, because actually, and this is a perfect segue, because in our next, we're going to get to talking about what you do, but we just happened so naturally. In our next episode, we're going to be covering the film U.S. Go Home.
Oh, yeah.
And Radio Caroline is featured in the little bit of that that I saw in the version you sent me where it's all the sound is all messed up. But isn't Radio Caroline plays a role in that, right?
I believe this is true. So there you go.
Yeah. And the film is in French. So even though that's not silence, it's kind of like sounds devoid of meaning to someone who doesn't speak French. And if you're Roger Avary, you're like super excited because you like French girls. Okay, well, and you know who else likes French girls? Francis Ford Coppola. I don't know if he does. I don't even know if that's true. But on Brian's other podcast that he does with his co-host, AJ Gonzalez, they do the Director's Wall. And the Director's Wall is a podcast where they look at every film in a director's canon. And they started off with M. Night Shyamalan for season one. And in season two, they're doing Francis Ford Coppola. Frankie Ford Cops, as we call him.
Frankie Cops.
Yeah, Frankie Cops.
Yeah, we're doing it right now. I mean, when you're listening to this, this is going to be now October. But like right now, we're in the shit. We're watching like five versions of Apocalypse Now. And I still have two left. And gosh, it's an ordeal. It's a thing. But I bet when this airs, I maybe will be touching up on a Tucker Man in His Dream is maybe my guess, late 80s. So yeah, tune into that. It's fun.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a great podcast. I'm a huge Coppola fan, and I think we have some crossover episodes in our future. There's a couple of films that are heavily on my list of The World is Wrong films that when you get to them, I'm going to bust down that director's wall, come through it like the Kool-Aid guy.
The Kool-Aid guy. Oh, yeah. Oh, Tetro. Yeah,
the Rainmaker.
I like this.
So, okay. Well, thanks a lot to everyone who is at this point. You know, we don't know for sure, but at this point, I'm just going to say the response to this show has been staggering. You people, you're amazing. The letters and the emails and the shout outs and the likes and the great reviews and the requests for bookings. And I mean, damn, Bryan, did you ever think it could be like this?
I know. I didn't think I would make $1 million off a podcast, but I did. Of course, we're pre-recording this and hoping that in October all these things will happen, you know.
Put it out there. Put a dream out there, man. Tucker, a man in his dreams. Bryan, a man in his dreams. I think the world is ready for a podcast called The World is Wrong, and we're here to serve you. And, you know, whatever. You know what? If there's only two or three of you left at this point, there's even more gratitude on our part for hanging with us through whatever it is that pissed everyone off back in the Rules Don't Apply episode. So anyway, thanks a lot to all of you, and wherever you are, just remember, the world is wrong, and it's probably wrong about you.
Done. Good job.
Now I'm going to ask you one more time, Richard. Kindly remove your sunglasses. Very well, then. Why don't you tell us about school?
Tell us about school.
Ziggy. Oh, Rick, don't smoke.
He's about to smoke here, Richard. I don't
think. My name is not Richard.
Oh, well, then what is it?
Dick.
What?
Dick. You heard me.
No, your name is Richard.
Sorry, it's Dick.
Well, then, Dick,
How is school?
It sucks cock. Yeah, it does.
And what classes are you taking, Dick?
Gangbang 101, freebase tutorial, and oral sex workshop.
Well, then, how are you liking that, Dick?
Yeah. Are you like?
What has happened to you?
What do you mean, what has happened to me? What do you think?
I can see what that school has done to you.
You know, maybe perhaps Paul and I should go up the stairs.
No.
No?
No. If anyone's going to leave this table, it's going to be Richard.
It's Dick!
All right, leave the table now, Richard.
Why?
I'm asking you to leave the table now.
No. I will not leave the table. No.
Oh! Leave the table.
Well, fuck you! And fuck you, and fuck you, pretty boy! And fuck you all very much! Oh, I'm out of here. Have a good one!
Radio 8 Ball.
Andras here. When I'm not co-hosting the World is Wrong podcast, I'm hosting and producing the Radio 8 Ball podcast, where we answer questions by picking songs at random, like picking musical tarot cards. We've hosted musical divinations for people like John C. Reilly, Patricia Arquette, Tig Notaro, and Fred Armisen, and hosted over 200 songwriters providing the randomly chosen answers, from Inara George and Dan Byrne to Mose Allison and Alan Toussaint. That's Radio 8 Ball, all one word. You can find us wherever you get your podcasts and download our app from the iTunes App Store.